We're going to go into a little bit of lock flow and lock release flow. So it's going to be, we're only dealing basically with two different types of locks. We call them specific names. Other arts will call them something else. Feel free to use their term. It doesn't matter. The application is pretty much the same across cultures, across functionality. So when you're working this for function, you have a specific way of doing it. If you're working it for culture, you have a surrounding meaning to it, and that doesn't really apply. We deal with function. So we call it a supine lock. There's supine position is here versus pronate lock. So I'm taking her hand from here and I'm bending it up. We're getting it. We call it a supine lock. And we generally have several different applications for it. So there's several different branching points to where it will extend for functionality. It can also be called the gooseneck lock. Chin-na will also call it something else. Again, minimal type of movement to impede the lock. We have, just so you know, Core JKD wrist and finger lock video that goes into an extensive series of locks and releases and so forth in that video. So this is a little bit that you'll see from that. We also have the sandwich lock. So if I put pressure out here on this side, she extends outward and goes into this, what we call a sandwich lock. So it's basically sandwiching my hand in a vertical position, in this awkward position, between both of her hands. So those are the two locks we're looking at. Supine, if I have pressure out here, she turns it into the sandwich lock. If I have pressure towards the inside, she turns it into a supine lock on me. So this is how we're going to do the flow. The lock flow is going to go like this, and it's based on the pressure that I put in. So you're going to start with one particular pressure to work just the supine for supine lock. So if I go here and I'm putting pressure towards the inside, sometimes I'll do that. There might be a reason. I may go here and work towards going underneath the person, setting the lock into a new position. So there is a reason that we do turn it to the inside. I may also turn it into a lock that goes into here. So there is a reason for both outside and inside rotation on the lock. So in this case, for this flow, so that she can turn it back into another supine, she's going to be working, attacking this one as I turn it in here. She's going to assist the turn, meaning she's going to use this hand to help turn it, my hand, into her waiting hand. So if this was just like this here, she sets it onto her thumb like that to the back of my hand. She grabs the meaty part of the thumb and secures the lock, just like that. What she's going to do is, as I rotate this towards center, she's going to set that into play, and then she's going to rotate it in towards center. Because again, I don't know where she's going. We're just working the feel for this so I understand the mechanics involved. My awaiting hand is there, but I'm going to assist. I'm going to direct how she's turning this in rotation. So I may not have strength to do this here or back here to resist what she's doing, but I do have side to side control to some degree. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn it so that her hand falls here properly. So that's part my work. It's not just letting her do this. And it's not me just reaching over and trying to grab and be awkward and don't be that person. So as this pressure is coming in, and I do this based on pressure, so she is giving me pressure and direction in that way. So I will assist feeding it to my hand a little bit, peeling off the meaty part of the thumb, and setting the lock in play. And going towards the center, she resets it, goes back to center, I reset it, she does it, and we go back and forth. That's kind of the flow. And then out of that, you can work a bit more firm control. So now I'm going to start putting a little bit more pressure. And this is over time. Don't do this right away if you haven't done this before. And the reason that is because the joints don't take a lot of repeated action under stress like this without inflaming. So if you're not used to that and you haven't stretched beforehand, which is really important, you haven't stretched in all these different ways. I go through stretching on that video. I go through a lot of different ways to make sure that you're conditioned for the training. I have a bit of an injury here, so there's a lot of swelling there. She's doing pretty well not activating that. So you always have to take into account injuries. You always have to take into account how far, how hard I'm doing this, how fast I'm going to apply it. Generally, when we're training, we don't sit there, especially in the beginning stages, I don't go like this and just crank it down. It's we get the technique down, and again, the video goes into exact technique, very detailed, on how to apply this so that you get maximum control and maximum pressure and a good secure lock. I won't go into that here. Right now, this one, this particular video is about the flow. So in here, I'm setting that into play and rotating it. She comes in, sets that and rotates it. It's a nice gentle type movement. We're working on getting our control into play. As we do this, we can then all also start putting into play our cover and things like that. So we're working towards that end. We're getting this now set up so that I have my base underneath me so that we have all this into play. And every time that she does this, she's going to give some direction. And that direction is going to help me go into that particular flow. Now, when I turn this to the outside, so the first one was towards the inside, this one is towards the outside. That's when she extends outward, rotates it over, and goes into the sandwich lock. Now, there's a lot of fine-tuning to get the sandwich lock to work really well under stress. That's covered in the video. Again, that's it, it's too much time to go into, and this video isn't about that detail. The video is about setting the lock and working it in a flow. Okay, then she sets it back to the supine, but she's turning it outward, so I go through here and I set this back into play here. I let it go and go back to the supine. Then I give that pressure to the outside. So now we're flowing to outside pressure. So in there, again, just like in some of our Wing Chun training, it's that extension of the finger, the index finger, which helps determine where I'm going, where I'm applying pressure and direction. And that helps us, especially in our early stages of training, to figure out where to go on this. Now, the actual lock is really a serious lock. So if she's putting that on me, I can put this in here and I can crank and I can tear a lot on this arm. The supine also has that devastating limb tearing functionality. So go light, especially if you haven't done this before. Don't start going crazy hard and fast. You have to allow enough experience and time on the job for your training partner to understand when pressure is too much pressure. We generally tap before ouch. If you get to ouch, it's too much. Now, it takes a lot of us who have trained harder and longer and under a lot of stress a lot longer to get to ouch. So we'll be under a great deal more of stress. We'll move with the control position, the strikes, things like that, a lot more than somebody who has no understanding of how to alleviate pressure on this at its earliest time. So don't expect your partner who may not have trained this before to understand what tapping is. And essentially tapping is we get to, I'm going to just go here and she will let me know. She knows her body under this hard training. So she will know where it gets to a point to where if she keeps doing this under this repeated type of stress, this will start getting inflamed. So she knows where that is. And that's where she taps at that point. Because I have control and because I have amount of time on my own body and knowing where I can set this into play, I can put this on with great speed, meaning I set it, but I don't apply it with great speed. So I can set, get in position, And then I've got the control. So far, there's no pain on her. Now, this is a pain-compliant lock, which means I can hold this all day long. If she moves against the joint, if she moves against the pressure, she's causing the pain. That's why it's pain-compliant. She's going to comply to the pain. In this case, a lot of the times, because of different lock site we can set up, it's because of actions she is doing that is causing the pain. So that's why you'll see law enforcement use them a lot more, because they are not specifically cranking down and tearing. Not that you can't do that. In a threat to life survival, you can actually tear. I've known people who have broken legs and torn limbs. So I had this one finger torn, you know, just the muscle sheath that controlled this going back on this side. I had to bind it for a year to my other hand, to my other finger, a really tight bind. I'm doing this right now. This is only an indicator for her to know not to crank hard or put too much digging pressure on this, because during training, we were grappling on hardwood floors. My hand was underneath me as I rolled over onto it, and these fingers went all the way back to here. So excruciating pain. Right now it's just swelling, so but it's healing well. So this is to let her know this is the hand that's injured. That's all. So do that sort of thing. Mark your body up so that your partner knows, okay, this is the one that's injured. Don't deal with your devastating stuff on that. In this training, it's all about the flow, and it's about feeling the energy of where they're directing the lock so that you can then flow into the counter lock. So if you're training this with your eyes closed, it actually helps. And again, you just have to not be rushing for this and not be trying to put your ego into play and saying, I'm going to get this lock. It's not about getting the lock. It's about understanding when the pressure and the direction of the pressure makes it functional for me to use this kind of escape or counter lock versus this kind where the pressure is towards the inside. That's what this is about. So yeah, you're gonna put it here, and you're gonna put it here. Oops. The channels between here and the channel between here. So you'll feel where her bones separate, and then your distance up will determine how much pressure you've actually got versus the limb. So if it's too low, you won't get as much pressure, especially against really strong people. And if it's too high, you lose the risk the chance of slipping it off the joint. Okay.